Produced between 1974 and 1987, the Alfetta GT and GTV not only had the unenviable task of replacing the much-loved 105 Bertone Coupés, but they had to do so in a much more challenging world. With two oil crises during the 1970s and a general decline in demand for coupés in the 80s, it's no wonder the Alfetta-based coupés ultimately sold in significantly smaller quantities than their forebears. Yet they can hardly be considered a failure, and these hugely charming automobiles now rightfully enjoy well-deserved recognition among Alfa Romeo fans. Work on a larger, more spacious coupé than the existing Giulia GT started as early as 1968, with the first studies still based on the newly launched 1750 GTV's running gear. However, with Alfa's engineering department already hard at work on what would be the Alfetta, it was wisely decided to switch the new coupé studies to the newer, more modern platform, albeit with 11 cm shaved off its wheelbase. The mechanical package was different, but the project's mission remained the same: to provide significantly more room for four people and their luggage than the existing Giulia GT, while maintaining a sleek, sporty appearance. Giorgetto Giugiaro's striking fastback wedge design directly resulted from those opposing targets, and it looks just as good today as it did nearly 50 years ago. The Alfetta GT's timing could hardly have been worse. It was launched in the summer of 1974, in a world still reeling from the oil embargo, with a tanking economy and fuel prices that certainly didn't incentivize sports car sales. Just like the Alfetta Saloon a couple of years prior, the Alfetta GT was initially available with a single engine option, Alfa's 1.8L twin cam inline 4 fed by two side draft 40mm carburetors and rated at 122 horsepower at 5500 rpm. These early models can be recognized by looking at their front vans, devoid of the cooling slot that were added to the subsequent models, those introduced in 1976. The original 1.8L model was superseded by the GTV 2L, while an entry-level 1.6L model was also introduced, but mainly aimed at the Italian market. The GTV 2L was characterized by rubber overriders on both bumpers, a grille with two shiny inserts on both sides of the Alfa shield, and a redesigned rear air outlet carrying the GTV moniker. Wood trim on the dash and a leather-rimmed steering wheel were standard equipment. Despite the larger displacement, though, peak horsepower and torque rating remained similar to the earlier 1.8L model, but that was rectified in 1979 with the introduction of the GTV 2L, with 130 horsepower, recalibrated suspensions, and a more luxurious upholstery inside. Between 1976 and 1980, the GTV was also made available on the US market, albeit disfigured by the Federal Spec bumpers and equipped with a detuned 110 horsepower engine with Spica mechanical fuel injection. Alfa Romeo's racing arm Autodelta rallied the Alfetta GT in 1975 in the Group 2 category, with encouraging results, while Carlo Chiti got busy designing a contender for the full-fat Group 4, a true monster equipped with a 3L V8 engine derived from the Montreal. The Alfetta GT V8 proved blisteringly fast in testing, but the project soon had to be abandoned on cost grounds. Alfa Romeo would have had to build 400 road cars for homologation, but the production of the Montreal's V8 had ceased and crucial tooling was already unavailable. However, a few lucky German enthusiasts did manage to get their own GT V8. Built by AutoDelta using stock 2.6 liters fuel-injected Montreal units on behalf of Alfa Romeo's German subsidiary. By the late 1970s, turbocharging was increasingly seen as the way of the future, and AutoDelta hatched a new rally program around a turbo derivative of the GTV 2 liters L, known as the TurboDelta. The minimum production requirement of 400 road cars to obtain homologation in Group 4 was fulfilled without disrupting Arese's production schedule. The cars left the line as regular GTVs that were then transformed at AutoDelta's facility 12 km away in Settimo Milanese. The KKK turbocharger blew the intake air at a relatively mild 0.7 bars through the standard carburetors, whose gasket and jets were replaced. New pistons lowered the compression ratio, while an uprated head gasket, new cams and radiator completed the package. The GTV TurboDelta's rally career started in 1980 at the Rally Costa Brava, and throughout the season, the Alfa Romeos proved fast yet unreliable, often retiring from leading positions. Unfortunately, AutoDelta would not be given the time to develop the car properly, as the rally program was shut down in early 1981. Arese's coupes were restyled for 1980, and in keeping with period's fashion, all brightwork became black, with the outdated stainless bumpers replaced by plastic items. However, expensive sheet metal changes were kept to a minimum, as Alfa Romeo simply couldn't spare the necessary funds. The interior saw a new, more traditional-looking dashboard that only partially addressed the model's ergonomic shortcomings. The 1.6 liters model was dropped, and the 2 liters GTV became the entry-level model, leaving the range topper's role to the new GTV6. It's fair to say that the all-aluminum 2.5 liters V6 engine, rated at 160 horsepower at 5600 rpm, transformed the GTV and gave it a new lease of life, not just on the market, but on the racetrack as well, as it won for Alfa Romeo 4 European Touring Car Championships in a row. Speaking of racing success, I must mention the GTV6 3 liters produced in just around 200 copies for South Africa. The engines, crank, heads, pistons and liners were supplied by AutoDelta, and the Bosch fuel injection was dropped in favor of 6 Dell'Orto 40mm carburetors. But even rarer is the twin-turbo GTV6 produced by Callaway on behalf of Alfa's North American branch. Known as the Callaway C3, it is believed 30 to 35 cars were converted between 1983 and 1986. Although Alfa Romeo's Centro Stile made a few design proposals for a second restyling of the GTV around 1983, these plans were soon shelved, and the model soldiered on with the mildest of updates until 1987, when production was terminated without a straight replacement.